In Matthew chapter 24, verses 15 through 18, Jesus said, "Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house, and let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes." Jesus instructed us to flee for our lives when the abomination of desolation appears. Therefore, it's vital for us to understand what the abomination of desolation is. Misidentifying it can have fatal consequences. So what is the abomination of desolation? That's what I'm going to explain in this video. But before I do, I want to thank Doug Batchelor for sponsoring this video. Doug Batchelor is one of my favorite preachers, and he also has his own YouTube channel. I'm subscribed and watch his channel on a regular basis because it's a source of inspiration for me and helps me learn more about the Bible and get closer to God, and I recommend that you subscribe as well. Click on the card in the upper right-hand corner of the screen or the link in the video description to subscribe to Doug Batchelor's channel. Now back to the abomination of desolation. A clue to understanding what the abomination of desolation is given in Matthew chapter 24, verse 15. Because there, Jesus said Daniel the prophet spoke about the abomination of desolation. So we need to go back to the book of Daniel and see what he said about it. The abomination of desolation is mentioned in Daniel chapter 9, verses 26 through 27. It says, "And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself." This is in reference to the sacrifice of Jesus for our sins. "And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary." This is talking about the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple by the Roman army in 70 AD. "The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined." Water in Bible prophecy symbolizes people, according to Revelation chapter 17, verse 15. A flood symbolizes an army. Revelation chapter 12, verse 15 talks about the serpent spewing water out of his mouth like a flood after the woman in the wilderness. The woman in the wilderness symbolizes God's true church during the Dark Ages. And the flood symbolizes armies which the forces of Satan employed to persecute God's church. So in Daniel, when it talks about the end of it shall be with a flood, that may be an illustration of the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple by the Roman army in 70 AD. "Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering." This is in reference to the new covenant, which was based on Jesus' sacrifice for our sins. His sacrifice brought the Old Testament temple sacrifices to an end in the sense that they were no longer necessary because they were types and shadows which pointed to Jesus' sacrifice. "And on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation, which is determined, is poured out on the desolate." All things considered, the abomination of desolation is in reference to the destruction of Jerusalem by the Roman army, which happened in 70 AD. But don't just take my word for it. We read confirmation about that in Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21 is a parallel to Matthew chapter 24. They both talk about the Olivet Discourse, where Jesus outlined signs preceding the destruction of Jerusalem and the end of the world. And notice how Jesus described the abomination of desolation in Matthew chapter 24, verses 15 through 16, compared to Luke chapter 21, verses 20 through 21. In Matthew chapter 24, verses 15 through 16, Jesus said, "Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains." Luke chapter 21, verses 20 through 21, puts it this way. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let those who are in the midst of her depart, and let not those who are in the country enter her." Here, it identifies the abomination which causes desolation as Roman armies. The Jewish historian Josephus stated that in AD 66, Cestius Gallus, a Roman general, surrounded the city of Jerusalem with his soldiers, but then ended up retreating. The Christians of Jerusalem recognized this as the abomination of desolation which Jesus warned about and fled from Jerusalem to Pella, a town in the region of the Decapolis across the Jordan River. 4 years later, in 70 AD, the Roman army under the leadership of Titus returned to Jerusalem, besieged the city for 4 months, and burned the temple down. Josephus stated that over 1 million Jews died in Jerusalem, mainly as a result of violence and famine. But not one Christian died because they heeded Jesus' warning. The acts of the Roman army brought desolation or destruction to Jerusalem. But why was the Roman army considered an abomination? An abomination is something that is especially offensive to God. One thing that's identified as an abomination in the Bible is idolatry. Deuteronomy chapter 27 verse 15 says, "Cursed is the one who makes a carved or molded image, an abomination to the Lord, the work of the hands of the craftsman, and sets it up in secret." How this applies to the Roman army is the Roman army marched with idolatrous standards which they carried around with them. The book Imperial Cult and Commerce in John's Apocalypse by J. Nason Craybill states, "In the eyes of many Jews and Christians, the imperial army was a bastion of idolatry. A scroll from Qumran declares that Romans, Kittim, sacrificed to their standards and worship their weapons of war." Such a view was not far-fetched. Josephus reports Roman troops, after storming the temple at Jerusalem in 70 CE, carried their standards into the temple court and, setting them up opposite the eastern gate, there sacrificed to them. This is what the abomination of desolation meant for early Christians. And the reason this happened to the nation of Israel is because of their rejection of Jesus as the Messiah. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 23 verse 38, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more till you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Jesus called the temple here your house. Before he had referred to the temple as my house. For example, when he cleansed the temple in Matthew chapter 21 verse 13, he said, "My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves." This means that the presence of God had departed from the temple and Israel had forfeited God's protection. That's why destruction came upon Jerusalem and the temple. Jesus predicted this in Luke chapter 19, verses 43 through 44, stating, "For days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you and close you in on every side, and level you and your children within you to the ground, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation." Jesus repeated this warning in the parable of the wicked vine dressers in Matthew chapter 21 verses 37 through 41, stating, "The last of all he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the vine dressers saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir, come, let us kill him and seize his inheritance. So they took him and cast him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those vine dressers?" They said to him, "He will destroy those wicked men miserably, and lease his vineyard to other vine dressers who will render to him the fruits in their seasons. In answering Jesus' question, the religious leaders pronounced their own doom. But the abomination of desolation has another application as well, an end time application. After the seven last plagues which culminate in the return of Jesus Christ, the world will be desolated as the result of another abomination. Jeremiah chapter 4 verses 23 through 27 speaks of this, stating, "I beheld the earth, and indeed it was without form and void, and the heavens, they had no light. I beheld the mountains, and indeed they trembled, and all the hills moved back and forth. I beheld, and indeed there was no man, and all the birds of the heavens had fled. I beheld, and indeed the fruitful land was a wilderness, and all its cities were broken down at the presence of the Lord by his fierce anger. For thus says the Lord, the whole land shall be desolate, yet I will not make a full end." The seven last plagues and the return of Jesus, which Jeremiah calls the presence of the Lord, will bring desolation to the world. The question is, what is the abomination that leads to this desolation? Isaiah chapter 24 has the answer. In a prophecy about the desolation of the earth, in verses 1 through 6, verses 5 through 6 tell us, "The earth is also defiled under its inhabitants, because they have transgressed the laws, changed the ordinance, broken the everlasting covenant. Therefore the curse has devoured the earth, and those who dwell in it are desolate. Therefore the inhabitants of the earth are burned, and few men are left." The future desolation is brought on by the abomination of transgressing God's laws by changing the ordinance, which breaks the everlasting covenant. The laws it's talking about here are the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments are called God's covenant. Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 13 says, "So he declared to you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, the Ten Commandments, and he wrote them on two tablets of stone." The Ten Commandments are also eternal. Psalm chapter 111 verses 7 through 8 says, "The works of his hands are verity and judgment. All his commandments are sure. They stand fast forever and ever, and are done in truth and uprightness." Therefore, the Ten Commandments are an everlasting covenant. So what is this ordinance that gets changed in the Ten Commandments, which will lead to the desolation of the world? The word ordinance in Isaiah chapter 24 verse 5 is translated from the Hebrew word kok, which can mean a set time. And in the context of the Ten Commandments, there's only one commandment that deals with time. And that is the fourth commandment, the one that tells us to keep the Sabbath holy on the seventh day of the week. It's outlined in Exodus chapter 20 verses 8 through 11, stating, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it." The only problem with that is, most of the Christian world is not keeping this commandment as it is written in the Bible. Most of the Christian world keeps Sunday holy as the Sabbath. But that's not the seventh day of the week. That's the first day of the week. That's apparent for a couple of reasons. One, the Jews who have been keeping the same day as the Sabbath for thousands of years keep Saturday holy as the Sabbath. And two, everybody knows that Jesus was resurrected on a Sunday, and the Bible calls that the first day of the week in Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 6, stating, "Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they," that is some of the female followers of Jesus, "and certain other women with them, came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen." That means that since Bible times until now, a change has been made to the Sabbath. Who made this change and how was it changed? It started with the Roman Emperor Constantine the Great in 321 AD. He passed the first Sunday law, stating, "On the venerable day of the sun, let the magistrate and people residing in cities rest, and let all workshops be closed. In the country, however, persons engaged in agricultural work may freely and lawfully continue their pursuits." Because it often happens that another day is not so suitable for grain growing or for vine planting, lest by neglecting the proper moment for such operations, the bounty of heaven should be lost. The Church of Rome followed the leadership of Constantine, and in 364 AD, at the Council of Laodicea, the Church passed a law stating, "Christians must not Judaize," which means to do as the Jews do, "by resting on the Sabbath, but must work on that day, rather honoring the Lord's day, and if they can, resting then as Christians. But if any shall be found to be Judaizers, let them be anathema from Christ." This was done in order to try to stamp out biblical Sabbath keeping, because some Christians were apparently still keeping the seventh-day Sabbath holy. So as you can see, the change of the Sabbath was not by the authority of God's word, but by the authority of man. The Church of Rome even admits this in the Convert's Catechism of Catholic Doctrine, stating, "Question, which is the Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church in the Council of Laodicea transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday." Question, why did the Catholic Church substitute Sunday for Saturday? Answer, the Church substituted Sunday for Saturday because Christ rose from the dead on a Sunday and the Holy Ghost descended upon the apostles on a Sunday. Question, by what authority did the Church substitute Sunday for Saturday? Answer, the Church substituted Sunday for Saturday by the plenitude of that divine power which Jesus Christ bestowed upon her. In other words, it was by her own authority. Now, the change of the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday is significant because it's a violation of God's word. Because God never gave anyone the authority to change his commandments. In addition, the Sunday Sabbath originated from pagan sun worship. The Babylonians called the sun god Shamash and worshipped him every Sunday. And sun worship was prevalent in ancient times. The Egyptians worshipped the sun and they called him Ra. The Assyrians called him Baal. The Canaanites called him Moloch. And the Romans called him Sol Invictus, which means the unconquerable sun. Emperor Constantine, who passed the first Sunday law, was a pagan sun worshipper before supposedly converting to Christianity, and his Sunday law was a compromise between Christianity and paganism. Therefore, the Sunday Sabbath is idolatrous in nature since it originates from sun worship, and sun worship is one of the greatest abominations in the Bible. For example, in Ezekiel chapter 8 verses 5 through 16, God revealed to Ezekiel various abominations that worshippers in God's temple were committing. These abominations including idol worship and women weeping for Tammuz, a pagan god. But the greatest of these abominations was sun worship. Verses 15 through 16 say, "Then he said to me, 'Have you seen this, O son of man? Turn again. You will see greater abominations than these.' So he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, and there, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east, and they were worshiping the sun toward the east. Today, many Christian churches have retained the Sunday Sabbath, and many members of those churches think they are doing God's will by keeping Sunday holy because they have never prayerfully researched the issue of the Sabbath. And I think that when someone keeps the Sabbath holy on Sunday out of ignorance, God accepts their worship because they don't know any better. But once they come to an understanding that the Bible Sabbath is actually on Saturday and that the Sunday Sabbath originated from pagan sun worship, they will be held accountable for their actions. And this issue is going to become increasingly important as we near the second coming of Jesus, because Bible prophecy predicts that Sunday worship will be enforced by law, starting in the United States and then on a global scale. And once that happens, this abomination will lead to the desolation of the world, because the seven last plagues will be poured out. Some of you may be saying, that's crazy, nobody's ever going to enforce Sunday worship. Well, first of all, this wouldn't be the first time Sunday laws would have been enforced. Like I mentioned before, Constantine passed the first Sunday law in the Roman Empire. And in America, from the moment the Puritans arrived, they began enforcing laws to reserve Sunday for churchgoing. An online post entitled Blue Laws by USHistory.com states, "The first laws regulating public activities on Sundays were passed in colonial Virginia in the 1620s. Similar laws intended to keep the Sabbath holy were soon adopted elsewhere in America. Typically, all forms of trade or commerce were outlawed. No public entertainment or meetings were permitted, except, of course, for church services, which often included two-hour services in the morning and the afternoon. Travel on Sunday was banned, except for emergencies. Violators were subject to fines imposed by civil authorities." Though most blue laws have been relaxed or repealed in most states, they are still enforced in some other states. What's interesting, though, is that even though the First Amendment guarantees freedom of religion in the United States, the U.S. Supreme Court has held blue laws as constitutional numerous times, citing secular bases such as securing a day of rest for mail carriers, as well as protecting workers and families, in turn contributing to societal stability and guaranteeing the free exercise of religion. In addition, on May 21, 1888, a National Sunday Rest Bill was proposed to Congress by Senator H.W. Blair. Its purpose was to secure to the people the enjoyment of the first day of the week, commonly known as the Lord's Day, as a day of rest, and to promote its observance as a day of religious worship. Fortunately, the Seventh-day Adventist Church sent A.T. Jones into Congress, and there were others there as well, that argued that this bill was contrary to the American Constitution. It was defeated. It was not passed. Some people think that a Sunday rest or worship law would be a good thing, but history has taught us that when governments enforce religion, it leads to persecution of minority religious groups. That's why the First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States of America was written. It prevents the government from making laws which respect an establishment of religion and prohibit the free exercise thereof. This is designed to keep church and state separate, and this is what Jesus meant in Matthew chapter 22, verse 21, stating, "Render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." A wall of separation between church and state is necessary not only so that governments don't interfere with religion, but so that particular religions don't influence the government to pass laws supporting their religious beliefs. But that's going to change in the future, and an amendment to the Constitution will be made, and a Sunday worship law will be enforced, and everyone who wants to stay true to God's word and keep the Bible Sabbath holy will be persecuted. Speaking of the United States of America, Revelation chapter 13 verse 11 says, "Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb and spoke like a dragon." The United States starts out lamb-like. The lamb is a symbol of Jesus Christ. So it starts out Christ-like in nature. It promotes Christian values, like the separation of church and state. But then it ends up speaking like a dragon. The dragon symbolizes Satan, and Satan is characterized by oppression. Therefore, the United States will repudiate its Christian values and become intolerant to and persecute those who want to stay true to Christ. This will happen when Sunday worship is enforced. This is the abomination that causes desolation. The act of enforcing Sunday worship will be a rejection of Christ because it's a rejection of God's word and what it says about the Sabbath. Enforced Sunday worship has another name in the Bible. It's called the Mark of the Beast. And according to Revelation chapter 16 verses 1 through 2, when the Mark of the Beast is enforced, the seven last plagues will be poured out. It says, "Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, 'Go and pour out the bowls of the wrath of God on the earth.' So the first went and poured out his bowl upon the earth, and a foul and loathsome sore came upon the men who had the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image." Also, there are influential people in the world today who want to see Sunday enforced as a day of rest or worship. For example, Pope Francis, in his encyclical about climate change entitled Laudato Si, On Care for Our Common Home, wrote, "Sunday, like the Jewish Sabbath, is meant to be a day which heals our relationships with God, with ourselves, with others, and with the world. The law of weekly rest forbade work on the seventh day, so that your ox and your donkey may have rest, and the son of your maidservant and the stranger may be refreshed. Rest opens our eyes to the larger picture and gives us renewed sensitivity to the rights of others. And so the day of rest, centered on the Eucharist, sheds its light on the whole week and motivates us to greater concern for nature and the poor." Notice how he compared Sunday to the weekly law of the Sabbath, indicating that it would be good for a Sunday law to be enforced. The Vatican is in favor of a Sunday law. An online post by the New York Times entitled "Pope Francis Has a Few Words in Support of Leisure" states, "Last October, about 250 bishops met in Rome for a conference on the movement called the New Evangelization, which focuses on reawakening faith in those already baptized. One of their conclusions was, even though there is a tension between the Christian Sunday and the secular Sunday, Sunday needs to be recovered, in keeping," they wrote, "with John Paul's Dies Domini." What's significant about that is in Dies Domini, John Paul wrote, "Therefore also in the particular circumstances of our own time, Christians will naturally strive to ensure that civil legislation respects their duty to keep Sunday holy." Civil legislation means a law passed by the government to guard Sunday sacredness. In addition, while debating a bill about guns a few years ago, Arizona Senator Sylvia Allen said it would be good if a Sunday law would be passed.
"And how we get back to a moral rebirth in this country, I don't know, since we are slowly eroding religion at every opportunity that we have. Probably we should be debating a bill requiring every American to attend a church of their choice on Sunday."
Not to mention, there are already Sunday rest laws in several European countries. For example, in Poland, the country where I live, supermarkets and many other stores are closed on 3 Sundays out of the month because of a law that was passed a couple of years back. Next year, 2020, Sunday shopping will be banned every Sunday. You think something like this can't happen in the United States? An online post by the National Catholic Register entitled "Taking Sunday Seriously, Poland Leads the Way" indicates that Poland's Sunday law is an example for the United States. It states, "The European nation's new law sharply restricting Sunday shopping provides an opportunity to take a closer look at American habits." Granted, Poland's Sunday rest law isn't forcing anyone to worship on Sunday right now, but it's a step in that direction. It's only a matter of time. Check out the Kingdoms in Time prophecy movie by Amazing Facts. This is a 60-minute documentary hosted by Doug Batchelor, who explores the most striking Bible predictions that have come true. Click on the link in the video description to watch the trailer and order a copy for yourself on DVD, USB drive, or to stream it online. Jesus warned his apostles about the abomination of desolation and told them to flee Jerusalem when they would see it. When the Roman army, carrying its idolatrous banners, surrounded Jerusalem in 66 AD, they recognized that as the abomination that Jesus warned about and fled Jerusalem. 4 years later, in 70 AD, when the Roman army returned, it destroyed Jerusalem and the temple, but not one Christian was harmed. The abomination of desolation in our day is going to be the enforcement of the Sunday Sabbath. The Sunday Sabbath originated from pagan sun worship, and sun worship is one of the greatest abominations in the Bible. This abomination will lead to the seven last plagues, which will culminate in the return of the Lord and will desolate the world. And just as Christians fled Jerusalem when they recognized the abomination of desolation in their day, when Sunday legislation is enforced, that will be a sign for Christians to flee the cities of the world into wilderness regions like the mountains to wait for the return of the Lord. Has this video convinced you of the importance of keeping the seventh-day Sabbath holy? And would you like to find a Sabbath-keeping church near you? Just Google Seventh-day Adventist Church and your city, or email me at BibleFlockBox@gmail.com and I'll try to help you find a church near you. If you enjoyed this video, feel free to like it and share it. Check out some more of my videos by clicking on the screen. I have a lot of good Christian videos which I'm sure you'll enjoy if you liked this one. Please pray for my channel. Thank you for watching, and God bless you.